Now I would like to call Dr. Anderson to the stage. Dr. Anderson is an associate professor at the Department of Health and Medical Sciences, University of Copenhagen, Denmark. He is a lead cancer researcher in the field of translational genomics, focusing on hepatobiliary cancers for more than 12 years. He is also co-founder of the European Network for the Study of Cholangiocarcinoma, and he will be speaking on From Profiling to Personalized Predictive Therapy.
Thank you very much for the introduction. How do I, this one's for? Thank you. First, I would like to thank Stacy and all her volunteers for the great work of this foundation. It's a very unique situation compared to regular scientific meetings to engage with the patients, as I did last night as well. They're very heartwarming stories, and it's very hard to follow with a scientific presentation after such talks. My lab is focused on hepatobiliary cancers, and these are the indications that we're looking at. Maybe 85% of the work we do are mainly in intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma, and we follow on the right-hand side the path starting with the patients, and we also have patients in the middle, as the previous presenters have been saying. We go through molecular characterization, different genetic studies in matched models, preclinical animal models, and the idea is to translate back into the clinic. The four different themes that my lab is mainly focused on is patient stratification, new drugs or drug targets through that stratification, biomarkers of early diagnosis, which I think is the main thing we should be focusing on to actually solve this disease or cure this disease, and predictive signatures to understand how drugs are actually affecting patients in the clinic. I tried to set up a roadmap, but mostly it's actually to show you a picture of Denmark in the spring. This is right outside Copenhagen, and it's a mustard field. And it's the path that I think many of us could take. What I will be talking about is shown in red in the bottom part of the screen, is the patient stratification and classification, because my mission is to highlight the path from profiling to precision medicine or drug repositioning in the basic setting. Other areas that should be highlighted is investigating further into depth desmoplastic disease, understanding the stromal tissue, both as a way to understand resistance, but also how the tumor actually spreads in the body and how the stromal tissue helps to do so. And metabolic diseases, where the new company that I heard about yesterday, Komuta Healthcare, might be good to talk to envision with their enormous amount of data how different if they are the screen disappeared, how the different ethological factors actually affect the disease around well, that would be specifically U.S. of course, to go early in the disease and find markers for this disease. We all know why we're here, but this is still striking, and I wanted to put it up. So on one side is UK data for incidence rates, seen nearly estimated 4 times increase over 30 years. And in the US, the SEER data over 10 years here, indicating that both hepatocellular carcinoma and cholangiocarcinoma in men and women are increasing. And that is strikingly different from any other malignant indication out there. So there is a reason for why we're here. So starting with the roadmap for moving from profiling into modern day precision medicine, if you will, with next generation sequencing. I will point out first, as people are saying, why don't we sequence everybody? It's actually only 7 years ago the first prognostic gene classifier came out in the literature on cholangiocarcinoma. So we are still in baby steps, in the infancy of NGS and profiling of this disease compared to many other diseases that have profiling signatures way back from that. This was in 104 patients done when I was at the NIH. We used different types of mathematical models to build the classification. Here is gene expression data used for this. That was mostly what we had available in large scale at that time. Using other mathematical models to squeeze the data, separating the patient into good and bad prognosis, or good and bad clusters, identifying, based on this LEOAD1 class validation process, the main 238 genes that classify these patients according to overall survival and time to recurrence. Most interesting is the classification on the right-hand side, is the different things that represent these clusters. In good prognosis, it's immune-related genes mainly, and in the poor prognosis is all the rest we have heard about yesterday and also this morning. Inflammation, proliferative, RAS pathway, the mTOR pathway, PLK we heard from in the TIGER consortium yesterday, KRAS mutation, BRAF mutation, and all kinds of other mutations. And I highlighted here the receptor tyrosine kinases. This is unpublished data, quite old actually, but still unpublished. Identifying in those same cohorts in good and bad prognosis that these receptor tyrosine kinases, he highlighted by HER2, MET, and EGFR, indeed are overexpressed also in the protein state, not only in the gene expression state in these patients. Highlighted in the right-hand side with the red squares around are the poor prognosis groups grouped into two different independent patient groups compared to their good prognosis partners. And in case of all of them, the receptor tyrosine kinases, inflammatory markers such as COX-2, AKT, and activation of these, IL-6, as well as the MAPK pathway are all overexpressed in these patients. So CCA presents, in my view, an oncogenic addiction to receptor tyrosine kinase signaling. This I will not go into. It's very basic research. It's an animal model representing the poor prognosis group where we try to treat these mice, and patients are not mice, as one said yesterday. So we can do a lot in mice, which we cannot do in humans, unfortunately. But we can successfully, in this model, treat the mice using trastuzumab as Herceptin against the HER2 HER2O expressing tumor xenografts. We added on celecoxib, a COX-2 inhibitor that also targets AKT, and that in the, with the cell slash T part, the fourth group, elevated the response of this treatment quite significantly. Rather than taking this into a clinic, which has been done for each of these drugs by themselves, but not in combination, as I believe at least, we went back to the mouse model and identified a response signature, which we can use to predict the patient that might respond to this if it was taken to the clinic. So the treatment inhibits the tumor growth and prolongs the overall survival of these mice. That is the general thing. We can use the kind of data that we had just 5-6 years ago. Now, in the last 1 or 2 years, we have been involved in many different consortiums, TCDA, we also supported the TIGER LC, and I highlight in the bottom part of the slide our own take. Of course, I'll present our own work on this line, but mostly I will be presenting this because the vision of our project was different compared to the current stage where everybody is looked at as the same. We envisioned that we could identify the patients more cleanly by using the already known drivers, drivers here being IDS, KRAS, and TP53, and a group that did not have these mutations we call undetermined. They would go through multi-platform profiling, as well as then identifying their perturbation mechanism, and from that we could identify the drug targets. This is very busy, we don't have to go through that. The main part I will have time to talk about is the whole exome sequencing part in green. We also did targeted sequencing as validation, RNA-seq, and 450K methylation profiling on these patients, and all the data showed the same profiling. The most important part was that the envision was to group them into these four subsets, IDH, KRAS, TP53, and undetermined to spoil the next slides were further enriched for FGFR2 fusions and methyl-13 amplification at gene that did not have more than four papers at the time in PubMed, where there's actually 28 million papers. So not much known about that that gene. Now the screen fell out again. Anyway, so the idea was to subset these and identify their molecular targets. This map of the mutations are similar to all you've seen before, but it does highlight TP53, KRAS, and IDS being the most prevalent mutation in this disease, and a group that does not have any prevalent mutations. A more needle in the haystack or prevalent or passenger type view below of all the significant mutations in these 500 cases of intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma. More interesting in the right-hand side, or easier to follow at least in the right-hand side, you see how the different patients are represented by these driver mutations. So they're quite markedly mutually exclusive compared to what is typically believed in the literature. There is very little overlap between IDH, KRAS, and TP53. And then I also added in the FGFR2 fusions based on the RNA-seq and the undetermined group. Can I go one back? The most important slide in this presentation is likely the Venn diagram on the left-hand side, indicating the fact that all the mutations in these patients, all the genetic substitutions, are actually unique between these four different groups or the prevalent. Okay, we have technical issues, I think. Okay, I'm back. It's probably the most boring figure, but it's the most important one, indicating the fact that there is a unique grouping of these patients, and the needle in the haystack is important to look at. If you look at the right-hand side, we see the most prevalent drivers, not surprisingly, are KRAS, IDH, and P53, that tier one mutations, as we call them, or drivers, or prevalent drivers. Then there's a group in the middle, which typically goes into the passenger group for most studies, but we see them actually move up in what I would call a tier two or cooperative or mini driver situation, where they actually participate in these groups to form the disease. And those ones are mutations we actually ought to pay attention to because we cannot drug the other ones. And then we have tier three, that's the passengers. There are, of course, a clinical relevance to this intersection of the patient grouping. Both in the discovery cohort, indicating that TP53 and KRAS are the people with the poorest, or the patient with the poorest prognosis, and IDH is the one with the best and the undetermined, having none of these drivers in between. And it's also represented by the recurrence and validated in two different cohorts. So there's an enrichment and underlying alteration demonstrating clinical significance for this. Now, very science-based, basic science-based way of looking at things, but with importance potentially for exposure. Looking at the genetic substitution, so all the point mutations in your genome, looking at each of the different each of the nucleotides on either side, so having a trinucleotide pattern going across the genome, and summing it up for all the patients in the group. If you first look at the gray part on the left-hand side, the top panel called combined, it's all the patients. We don't see anything that's interesting. We see the transitions and transversions that just indicates that this is cancer. That is very similar to the undetermined group that doesn't have a driver mutation in our mind. At least we haven't found the driver. Whereas when we then specify into the IDH, KRAS, and TP53 group, we see very unique genetic substitution patterns. And looking at the cosmic signature database for these genetic substitution patterns, we know that IDH is signature 18 and 28, that's oxidative stress, KRAS is ApoBec signature 2 and 13, and P53 is exposure to chemicals such as aristolochic acid, and that's signature 22, and undetermined, nothing. So if we had just looked at this patient as one cohort, we would have seen nothing, is the take-home measure of this. Specific genetic substitution patterns directs unique network perturbations, but we need to subgroup them to see it. When we then combine this data together with the functional pathway association, so looking at all the mutations in the specific genes and how the genes are communicating together in signal transduction, we see in yellow on the left-hand, right-hand side the different unique pathways that each of these mutational profiles in the patient subsets are actually affecting. So there's an example, IDH, since we heard about IDH earlier today, is pathways, particularly in metabolism, And I would like to point out the undetermined, which has no unique mutations, but were the largest group of patients, nearly 45% of the patients, have one pathway that are associated to all the mutations in there, and that's mTOR. That's important for the next slide. So to take it to the endpoint, and to take it to drug repositioning, as we have heard a lot of people asking for, we designed patient matched models, not just matching to the driver mutation, IDH, KRAS, and P53, or not having those ones, but as much as we could match basic models in the lab to the entire genome alterations that were in these patient subsets, as best possible. It's not 100%, of course. We had 8 different models. We used a library at the Finnish Institute of Molecular Medicine, 525 selected FDA-approved drugs. And we use a drug sensitivity score developed at that department, where we look at proliferation or difference in proliferation, as well as the cytotoxicity. So the screen was run twice on each of these cell lines at the log difference of 5 for the concentration. Then at the bottom part, we selected for drugs that are effective in each of these groups. There is a 5th group, if you have noticed now, that's a mixed group. That's a cell line that represent patients that would have had KRAS and IDH and P53 combined, and then we see no response to these ones. When we then overlay this with the genomic, with the biological processes in the previous slide, we see something quite, at least to us, striking. That's the response in an IDH group, for example, is specifically to RNA synthesis inhibitors in all cases. KRAS is microtubule modulators, and P53 is topoisomerase inhibitors, and in undetermined, as I showed you in the last slide, is mTOR inhibitors, kind of validation that the data is solid. And the mixed, no response whatsoever. So driver gene subgroup enrichment of recurrent genomic alteration minimizes the heterogeneity, is what we believe, and elucidates unique regulatory pathways that to a large extent actually could be drugged if we tested them. It should be said that this is basic slash maybe translational science, and of course needs to be validated in a clinical setting if anybody wants to go in that direction. There are other indications, and we heard about that from Foundation Medicine and also talks yesterday, where genomic-driven information has been taken into already clinical trials, and one of the most missed examples of that is FGFR2 fusions, of course, here indicated with a response rate of nearly 20%. Also similar response rates as what we have heard from immunotherapies. And probably what we have to accept is good in cholangiocarcinoma. Other group that has been taken in is the IDH group of mutated patients. There are multiple trials, as we heard in the previous talk as well. One is dasatinib as well, and I believe that trial is still ongoing. These are the people that do the work. It's not me doing the work. Well, we were at a wedding, that's why we are very well dressed in this situation. Usually we're not that well dressed. These are all the collaborators. Very thankful for all the collaborations. Anything that I've been talking about is open for collaboration. I have a big amount of data available, both in models and in patients, and I'm very happy to collaborate with anybody. The last thing I would like to stress is a new initiative that I think has already been highlighted yesterday by Jesus Bernardes, is the Global Cholangiocarcinoma Alliance under the AMMF in UK. We hope that the website, if it's not already online, that it will be online very soon. And I urge you all to have a look on that. Thank you very much.